I was almost 9 years old. And as I said many, many times, having had terrible asthma, my parents took me to the movies all the time. My father took me to see this film. He'd take me to see Westerns and war films and musicals, but sometimes take me to the masterpieces. I don't know how, you know, a guy who was working in the garment district for 40 years picked up on The River, you know, to go see this thing. It turned out to be one of the most formative movie experiences. And I know I say that about a number of films, but this was something different and special, particularly the use of color. There's no doubt about that. I would say this and The Red Shoes are the two most beautiful color films ever made. But I think something else happened when I saw that picture. It was the first exposure to a very foreign culture. I mean, I was exposed to Italian culture, of course, but with different Italian-Americans, Sicilian-Americans, Sicilians, and having seen Italian neorealism on film. But this picture was different. It looked like no other movie I'd ever seen. It was the first color film to be shot in India, and it turns out to be the first Technicolor film, first use of color by Renoir himself. I didn't know the name Renoir at the time. My family were not educated, and so I didn't know Renoir. But I was 9 years old, and I was coming out of third grade, I think, in parochial school, St. Patrick's Elementary School. And I remember vividly in third grade seeing paintings for the first time and little postcards. And there was symbolic paintings, and there was Van Gogh's Starry Night. And a couple of them were these beautiful little girls and women on a picnic wearing beautiful dresses from the late 19th century France. Very, very rich and intense embracing of the subject matter by the painter. And I saw the name was Renoir. I don't know if I had made that connection when I saw the movie. But it was around the same time, you know. And then later I went to museums and actually saw his paintings, the father's paintings. But I think the color in the film affected me strongly. And no doubt the nature of the culture that it was depicting, albeit through Western eyes, was very important. I think Renoir wrote in his biography, he said that the Indians felt that it was better for Westerners to make a film about India through Western eyes because they didn't think that the Westerner could really understand the culture and know the problems, really understand the problems of the country they felt. At times, people see the film today and they say, well, you know, it's seen through colonialist eyes. Well, Rumah Garden, you know, lived there. And whether it's colonialist eyes or not, it still has truth to what it is to be a human being. Primarily, it's the story of a young girl coming of age, but there's something much more universal about it. Especially if I'm a young boy coming out of Lower East Side at the age of 9 years old, seeing this and identifying with the movie and feeling for these people. I guess some people would say, well, I like the exotic, you know, in culture. I happen to you know, respond to that. But it's more than just the exotic because clearly, quickly, you find out it's not just exoticism. There are problems. The people live a certain way, believe things differently. So at first, if the gold and the glitter and the color gets you, it's still the real power is the humanity in the film, the humanity of the culture, what it is to be Hindu and to see life a different way. I don't know if the film shows that, but it makes you interested in that, I think. It made me interested. So I had never been exposed to this sort of thing, particularly a film of this kind where, like the river itself, the Ganges River, the picture just flows. The story just drops you into the middle of a life at the point in which he's coming of age, where it's wonderful to be alive and also terrible things happen to young kids at the age of 12, 13, 14, that terrible time. It's a beautiful time, but it's a terrible time. They go through a lot of trouble, a lot of difficulties coping. And you feel this in this picture unlike any other, I think. I felt I was living with these people and that I had seen something very special because it was very different from traditional storytelling. The authenticity was beyond anything I had seen. I mean, I'd seen other films shot in India, let's say, or parts of it shot in India. I was used to watching Elephant Boy and other films by Robert Flaherty that were shown on television in the late 40s, early 50s, so that when I saw the opening shots of the river with the boats going down the river and the man working in the nets and you hear that music, the voices singing, there was a familiarity to the technique, which had to do, I think, with intercutting documentary footage with dramatic footage, stage footage. And what made this one even more special was the use of Technicolor. Renoir felt that for landscapes in Technicolor, it was important to avoid subtle colors, he said, because they become muddy or murky. And so the vegetation and the tropical vegetation was perfect for Technicolor because the colors were very strong, you know. So, I mean, the color was, his first use of color was very, very important as a character in the movie. There's no doubt he's the son of the Impressionist painter. I think you could see it in this film, especially the landscapes. And the way he frames trees at certain points, or when all the girls sort of follow each other and hide behind the bushes to watch who's going to get the first kiss from Captain John. It reminds me of one of his father's paintings. Little girls sleeping together Apparently, he took hours to arrange the legs the right way, and it looks like right out of the paintings of his father's work. So, you know.
This is my daughter, Melanie.
You also notice that there's a strangeness in a way, a kind of an odd approach to the acting. It's different from other pictures. And bottom line is that many of them are non-actors. You have Esmond Knight, you have Arthur Shields, and you have Nora Swinburne, you have some other actors. Adrienne Corey plays Valerie. You had actors in it, but they all seem to blend with these other people who seem a little awkward at times, but ultimately the actors sort of fit in with the non-actors, sort of balanced. For example, Thomas Breen, who plays the soldier who had lost a leg in World War II, he's very interesting because you could tell it's a non-actor, but he really lost a leg. And for what you may be feeling a little uneasy about in terms of delivery or lines and that sort of thing, and everyone gets past it right away because you know it's real. What he's feeling, the conflicts, the emotions that he's feeling, it's really there. You know, probably the toughest two moments in the movie, not necessarily Harriet's desperate act at the end, which is luckily she's okay, but there's two moments, and it has to do with the rivalry between Harriet and Valerie. The sparring between the two girls forces Captain John to get up and throw rings. And somehow the way he was playing it had a truth to it that was very powerful, you know? And the moment where he slips and falls because he has one leg was the most disturbing thing, the most upsetting moment I'd seen in movies for a long, long time. And of course, you're angry at the two girls for causing this, but on the other hand, you understand the tension. You could feel it. I couldn't describe it. I was 9 years old. I couldn't quite, but I understood the tension between the girls, and I understood the wanting to be favored by him and who he's in love with, and that's all the fantasy, all of that coming on. I understood that, but the result was a humiliation to this man, and also the brutal reminder that a part of him is missing, you know. And as you get older, you begin to learn more and more about that, and you feel more about that. But probably the toughest thing in the movie is Valerie getting the kiss, I think, because Harriet says that was her first kiss, right? She loses the first kiss. You really feel it. Maybe not fully as a 9-year-old, totally understanding the sexual context of it and all of that, but, you know, I just felt the hurt. You know, the film is very interesting because as it is like the river, the flowing, the endless flowing of life, it has simplicity and a beauty of everything that isn't passing, everything that's like transitory, everything's movement. Just life goes and then life, people die and then things come up again and life goes on. But also there's very disturbing moments in it. And I felt this when I first saw the picture. Bogey playing with the snake. He was obsessed with snakes. A little boy, pure innocence, and the snake coming out of the tree, pure evil, in a sense representing pure evil. I know there are many people out there who like snakes. It's fine with me. I personally have a little bit of a problem with it, but you know. When he's discovered dead, it's really upsetting. I couldn't even imagine something happening like that to people. Somehow, along with the beauty that you see in the world around you in the river and the beauty of family life, there is that toughness and brutality in the picture, too, which I think balances out just beautifully. Radha, who plays Melanie, who's a powerful beauty, hypnotic quality, the way she speaks and the way she moves. I mean, I've never seen anything of Indian culture up to that point. And I've got to understand, too, American audiences hadn't. Maybe in England they did, but we hadn't seen that. Melanie, she was half English, half Indian. Feeling her discomfort, feeling her confusion, there's something about her and her acceptance that you feel an emotional and dramatic resolve. You feel a sense of relief. Talking about accepting the place in life where you are, which kind of flowers in a way when there's this dream scene about the Lord Shiva. This was something that was so foreign to me and so fascinating. And I liked the dancing and I loved the music. And how the dance sequence is edited within the film. It was very advanced for the time. Even though it was pre-New Wave, it just didn't worry about time or space, just went. The framing, I think, for the most part, from head to toe, seeing the dance. And, of course, Renoir didn't have the dolly track, so Radha had to come forward herself for a tighter shot and then move back. But it the limitations forced him into certain decisions in the shooting of that dance sequence that makes it magical and special. Going back to Renoir's biography, he talked about wanting to make a film, and he read a review of the book by Rimmer Gordon in New Yorker and went around trying to pitch it with his agent in Hollywood. I never realized that until Peter Bogdanovich wrote about it, that Renoir, I never knew that he was out of fashion or couldn't get a job in Hollywood. You know, here he was trying to make a picture, India, you know, in color, and it would be interesting, young girls coming of age, and we can get a good actress for it, we can get Marlon Brando, he spoke to for playing Captain John, and, you know, it just never happened. And he realized, you know, it wasn't going to get made until Kenneth McElhoney, who was a florist, fell in love with it. And when he looked into who had the rights to the river, it was Renoir, so got together and financed the film. But ultimately, of course, they didn't have enough money to lure Hollywood stars. So, you know, in a way, what happened was that they made an experimental picture. I think it was his first really, you feel, an experimental movie, in a way, for the commercial market. Kids can see it around the world, you know. For me, it was an experience I had with my father in the movies. Somehow the emotions of the family and the love in that film, I felt, let's say, for him, and I couldn't express it, but the experience together was a loving experience seeing it. Then, in the late 50s, something unique happened in film history. A negative for Grand Illusion, long thought to be destroyed, or at least a dupe negative, was found. And the film was re-released as a major release for foreign films. And I sort of became obsessed with that film. I must say, after seeing that film maybe 40 times or 50 times, I still find that I'd rather see The River, you know. But there was something powerful about that movie. I don't want to get into that now, but it's Gabin and Freinet and von Stroheim, and the sublime sadness of it is remarkable. Then I saw Le Règle du Jeu, The Rules of the Game, which escaped me. It was very hard for me to get into understand the culture of the servants and the bourgeois in France. I enjoyed the movie, but I didn't quite go with its reputation as one of the greatest films ever made. I'm completely an outsider on that movie. I have no understanding of the culture and the world of that. But I think to the people in that world and all of Europe and all of what was happening between the two world wars, I think, you know, it is a very, very important movie. But the body of work that I know as Renoir has inspired me. What I mean by that is, like, it doesn't inspire me to go make a film about Goodfellas in a bar in Queens and guys being shot. It doesn't inspire me, certainly inspire me for that. But what it does and constantly does is to inspire me to get up and say, let's make films again. The purity of his work, the sense that he really understood the people that he was dealing with, and the sense that he kind of liked the people and liked the actors from what I could tell. That is something to always keep you going, that's the well that doesn't dry up, is the Renoir cinema.